Welcome back to Sunday Morning Quickies, episode 108 for the 24th of December, 2023. The Year in Review episode. We had a pretty good turnout for Year in Review. Over 500 photographs came in numerous emails. Fortuitously, we're not going to show all 500 photographs because some of those, well, a lot of them were all from the same person. But we've got lots of pictures. We even have some video for you. The lovely and talented Elizabeth is going to be joining us for this. And what we've done is we've taken all of your emails and then I randomly split them up. I'll start off, I'll read one, and while we're reading the email, we'll be putting pictures up on the screen that will go with what's being said, with the one exception where there's a little piece of video. I think that's one of mine, anyway.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, so this is going to probably take a while, so grab some coffee, and here we go. This first one is actually two emails from Andrew and Mandy Wilson of New Zealand. They're close enough that I'm going to combine them both into one story for the Year in Review episode. The first email was something that was sent a couple of weeks before, but it wound up talking about the same machine, and I think you'll be interested in that. So we'll start with this. Hi, Bob. I'm in the middle of a teardown of a schmusty. I love that word, schmusty. I'm going to start using it.
What is schmusty?
I don't know, but I'm going to start using it. 201K3. Poor old girl has been badly neglected, most likely in its table in a garage by the sea. I lubed her up last week until she was straight from the wild. She rattled and clanked and tried hard to move. So this week, with lots of oil in all good places and no problem turning over, I got her out again. Stuck a 66 spoked wheel and a chinesium hand crank on it, and just for the heck of it, threaded up her rusty needle and all and test stitched so I could check out if she could actually sew. Blow me down, as with the oiling, she got better as she went. Not a perfect stitch, but after a bit of practice, she even sewed in reverse, in almost total silence.
Wow.
So then I started tearing her apart for cleaning and redoing the shellac. May have to rethink that. Some of the paint is flaking off around the edges. Got most of it done, except the take-up arm. It won't budge. And I've completely removed the grub screw, applied lots of penetrant, tried gentle tapiology from the back, heat, what next? Also, down at the bottom, the bobbin case area has a lot of rust. Do I need to remove the whole thing like I would on a 6699 to clean it? I think that's major. Picks attached. Thoughts, please. Yeah, you got to pull it out. You got to take it apart. But I just did a video on how to do that. We continue with the actual Year in Review email. First, Merry Christmas. Best wishes to you and yours, especially Liz, Rita, Wilson, and Roscoe. Well, the other cats won't. They're hurting. Feelings won't be hurt. Here we're just getting some warmth, which means I can do stuff outside. Hooray. Anyway, here's my project. A few years ago, I bought an old Orphan 201 for $20. Part of its trip to me was in a cruising motorbike saddlebag. Thought you'd like that. The shellac was shot, the paint was chipped with rust showing underneath, and I left it stewing for a while. Next, I expressed wish for a cabinet I could chuck it into and maybe have foot and electric power. So this cabinet came up for $24 within a week. The universe listened. I knew the seller. You'd get on well. The only room he hasn't got machines stacked everywhere is the bathroom. I never thought of that, actually, but it's an idea. And he'd get it to me somehow. So it arrived. I knew it was covered in decals with black paint underneath it. The decals turned out to be wallpaper and lasted a whole 5 minutes after stopping the car. Beautiful mahogany teasing me underneath. Didn't take all that long to strip it, but then the fun really started. Under the black paint was a white undercoat. Not many dings or scratches, but so much borer, which is the New Zealand version of woodworm. Ew. And I pulled it apart completely to refinish it easier. Must have been imported as a flat pack anyway. So now I have to find some donor brown mahogany and swap the door hinges and redo 48 screws, as apparently it does matter which hinge goes where. Anyway, state of play. The 201K is soaking in stripper to be repainted in a blue, green, purple color shift.
Oh,
that's
wow.
going to be cool. The cabinet is in the process of having holes filled, 99% done, and I just need to find some timber in another shed to fix the nasties and put it all together. Two points of interest to me are, first, the treadle wheel has never been used, only the controller. The ball bearings look brand spanking new. Second, this came from Hawke's Bay, whose main city, Napier, was destroyed by a huge earthquake in 1931. I'm thinking maybe someone bought a new machine to replace the one lost in the quake. Maybe. Napier is now our Art Deco city, as all the rebuilds date from immediately after the quake. I thought this might be cool. My poor husband, by the way, has just about lost hope of having meals cooked and chores done. I admit I'm really focused on this one. My birthday is in a couple of days, so it's my serendipitous present. Cheers, Mandy. Happy birthday, Mandy!
Yes,
might be belated at this point, but happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Elizabeth?
Okay. From Elaine Kieffer. Kieffer.
I think it's Kieffer.
Not sure? Okay, sorry.
I think it's Kieffer.
Of Ontario, Canada. Dear Mr. Fowler.
By the way, excuse me. The only person that ever calls me Mr. Fowler is the bailiff when they say, will the defendant please rise?
My husband was at a yard sale in 2010. The gentleman that was having it asked him if his wife sews. He said, yes, she does. The gentleman handed him the Singer 128, complete with a bent hook. Bentwood cover, and said, you can have it. He was downsizing and just wanted it to go somebody who would use it since it was his mother's. He brought it home. I plugged it in. Gasp! And not only did it work, but I noticed it had an excellent stitch and tension. Does have all the original attachments and four original shuttle bobbins. However, it did look like it needed a belt. The one on it seemed to be dried out. Also, it has a BT7 motor, and I recognized grease ports, and I knew I would need motor grease. I did not know anything about doing any repairs, much less anything else it might need, so I put it away in a closet. Fast forward to March of 2023. I decided to do a search for vintage sewing machine repair, and you came up on YouTube with a video, taking apart a Singer 127. I can't thank you enough. That video and all the others gave me the information I needed as to what to look for, what the pieces all did, and the confidence to take the machine apart enough to do belt replacement and to take apart, clean, and oil as many parts as I could for my comfort level, which isn't very high. Luckily, the machine was reasonably clean. It could use your Midas touch. Unfortunately, I live in southern Ontario, Canada, and I don't need to tell you how heavy this machine is. Shipping to New Jersey would be costly. I know you have the same machine. I would love to see videos on you restoring it. There isn't much out there for the Singer 128 Bentwood models from the 1920s to 1950s. The machine was manufactured on December 22, 1923. It turns 100 this year.
It turns 100 today. We are taping this on the 22nd.
Okay.
Actually, the serial number was allocated on the 22nd, but that was 100 years ago to freaking day.
Happy birthday.
Yes.
I set to work in late April of this year and started sewing miniature quilts and table toppers just for the fun of it. I have attached a picture of them, and I have to say, there really is something about some sewing on these old girls. From the soothing sound to just thinking of who sewed on them in the past. And for a machine that's 100 years old, went through a major depression and world war, it works really well. Sometimes better than my modern Janome. So, as I celebrate her 100th birthday, I thought I would share this with you. I will continue to work on a miniature quilt every now and again to keep her going and just for pure enjoyment. Thanks again for sharing your knowledge and for all your time and work with your videos. I know how much time it takes to film and edit. You are one generous person. With sincere gratitude, Elaine Kieffer.
By the way, I happen to have sitting right next to me on a cart a BT-7 motor in really, really bad shape.
Yeah, it's ugly.
It's fugly. Wow. Well, thank you. That was awesome. The next one is from a gentleman I have lots of correspondence with, Eugene Slagle of Locust Grove, Virginia. Eugene and I email back and forth quite a bit about various things. He goes, Bob, I think you remember my daughter's 1907 Singer 66-1 Lotus machine I had gotten free earlier this year. Crusty, rusty, and locked up. After a few times with eBay on getting replacement parts, getting replacement decals, stripping the paint and refinishing, she now sews like she should have over 110 years ago. With your help and videos, I was able to make this success, and in time for my daughter's birthday. Eugene, you did a bang-up great job with that machine. Congratulations. Elizabeth.
Okay. From Frederick Huganir of Pennsylvania. Bob, I happened upon your YouTube videos to prepare a newly acquired 1949-201-2 to sew face masks after the outbreak of the COVID virus. Since then, I've relied on your videos as I continue to clean, tweak, and lube my machine. A bit of history. When I was a kid in the 50s, I messed around with my mother's 201-2 that was in a Singer number 40 Queen Anne cabinet, and by the 60s, I knew how to sew when I needed to. In the 80s, after I was married, I went to a country auction on a farm in central Pennsylvania and picked up for a song a running 201-2 in a Queen Anne cabinet, just like my mom's. Alas, I used it very little and it was moved into the garage when we needed space in the house. Later, it toppled onto the concrete floor, breaking the cabinet. Eventually, I needed space in the garage for my motorcycles. So I gave the 201-2.
It's a legit thing. It happens.
And its cabinet. When the COVID virus arrived and paper face masks were reserved for medical personnel, patterns for cloth masks were being published in newspapers and online. But I no longer had a sewing machine. I hunted and found near Lebanon, PA, a very nice 201-2 in a Bentwood case. I could not get used to sewing with a machine on top of a base in turn on top of a table, and I yearned for a knee controller. So, near Johnstown, PA, I collected a number 40 cabinet, Queen Anne cabinet holding an anniversary 15-90 originally owned by Arnold Palmer's aunt.
Now that's pretty cool.
That's pretty interesting, yeah. Yes. I moved the 201-2 into that cabinet. A new owner picked up the 15-90. I collected other old things, not sewing machines. And the bent wood case went to my garage. When I bought the 201-2, the seller said he had had it serviced at his local vacuum and sewing machine shop and told him the machine was in amazing condition for its age. And yet, from memory, I knew a few minor parts were missing. I followed Bob's instructions to clean, lube, and adjust it as well as I could, and I even bought a set of hollow ground screwdrivers to do the job. I opened the potted motor and it was relatively clean. No gunk and wires in the housing were clean and hadn't deteriorated or cracked. I suspect that's what impressed the serviceman. Still, I knew that old wire insulation can look good but be brittle, so rather than messing with it, I reinstalled the housing to leave well enough alone, for now. I installed a modern cord and LED light. The machine seems to run well and sounds great, but honestly, I have nothing to compare it with. Fred. P.S. Cause you ride, here I am 7 years ago in the Smoky Mountains on the last bike I owned, an 09 F800GS. When I was 65 before I ended decades of two-wheeling. P.P.S. Smudge the barn cat on top and Luna the stray. All our cats have been free.
Awesome. Absolutely
and
awesome.
And a rider as well.
And a rider. He gets a pass for the machine going, having to go away to make room in the garage for the bikes. But that's okay. This next one is from Karen Charles of Ocean City, New Jersey. And I have to preface this by saying that Karen came to me by way of my friend Jen Delio of Sewing Machine Rehab. They had been corresponding back and forth about an issue. Jen wasn't quite sure of the correct answer for something. They brought me into the conversation. Anyway, we're going to pick this up towards the end where Karen had actually sent me the year in review thing. She goes, "Hi, Bob. Using your Sunday morning quickies and Jen's featherweight channel, I was able to accomplish making my friend very happy. Most of all, I really enjoyed the journey." Karen had been refurbing a friend's featherweight, and we'll show you the video for that in just a second. But I don't think Jennifer is going to mind if I share her last part of our email correspondence. And my last part was, it pretty much echoed what Jennifer had to say. Jen wrote, "Karen, I love the video of your friend seeing her spruced up machine for the first time. That was precious. You did a wonderful job and you should be very proud. Thanks for working hard to restore some of these great machines and making people very happy in the process. A very Merry Christmas to you and yours, signed Jen." Here's the video of Karen's friend seeing her spruced up machine for the first time.
Karen, it's gorgeous. My arms curtain tonight. Oh, wow. Oh, she's gorgeous. Stop. Oh, this came out phenomenal. It doesn't even look like the same machine. Oh, it's so... Never in my wildest dreams did I ever expect it to look that good. That is gorgeous. Nice work, Mrs. Charles. Beautiful. Oh, look, I can't wait to start sewing. Would you stop barking? Oh, look at the difference in the stitches. He gets me in the ear every time I go to do that. This came out beautiful. Oh, wow. And it's sewing so nice. Oh, my God. I can't wait.
I don't know about you guys, but seeing Karen's friend see her machine for the first time after Karen fixed it up, that was just way too cool. Simply amazing. All right, Liz, what do you have?
From Lanette Martin of Macon, Georgia. Hello. I have two machines to tell you about. Ruger, my Singer 99K, and Colleen, my Singer 1591. I got both of the machines thanks to my husband, knowing about a 25 years long-running joke between my mom and me. I moved out on my own at 23 and took my mom's sewing machine with me, telling my mom I was going to borrow it to sew curtains for my new place and promised to bring it right back. Took 25 years, but I finally did keep that promise to bring her machine back. And along the way, gained a new hobby, skill I never imagined I would have. The Tale of Ruger. On September 1st, my husband went to his friend's gun and pawn shop to check on an order. When my husband got home, he told me he ended up buying something else since his order was delayed. I walked into the kitchen expecting to see a new air rifle, and there sat a very old, dirty sewing machine case. I opened it up, and the cutest little Singer sewing machine was held inside. After all my excitement and many hugs and kisses later, my husband said to me, "Now you can give your mom back the machine you borrowed." I spent the next few weeks cleaning Ruger up. However, even after a good cleaning and oiling, Ruger still didn't sew right due to a sluggish motor. By this time, I had watched and followed along to hours of sewing videos on YouTube and figured since I am a visual learner, I could easily follow along and take apart the motor. I was so nervous the first bit, but once I got into the housing, I was fascinated by the simplicity of things. To me, it was like a 3D jigsaw puzzle. In the end, I did find what was slowing down my machine. A giant clump of string was wrapped around the axle as it goes through the motor housing. I put everything back together, and Mr. Ruger sews like a dream. Ruger got his name as he came from the gun and pawn shop. Best gun shop purchase my husband ever made. my new old friend, Colleen. After I got Ruger working, I made plans to finally take my mom's borrowed machine back to her. My mom's machine is a 1950 Singer model 1591. I remember being 3 years old watching her sew my twin and I dresses on that machine. When we got old enough to sew, she taught us on her machine. My mom's was the only machine I had ever sewn on my whole life until I got Ruger running. The night before taking my mom's machine back, I was looking on Facebook Marketplace for a table to set Ruger up on when I ran across a Singer Model 1591 in an awesome Art Deco table. I fell in love with her, and she was only $50. A few messages were exchanged, and plans were set up to go pick up the machine. I ended up taking my mom back her Model 15 then. Within 15 minutes of leaving her house, I had my own Model 15. While going through the sewing table the next day, I found the name of the lady who owned the machine before me. It was very evident that Mrs. Colleen had been the only owner of the machine, so I decided to name the machine after her. I also discovered that her family had put some kind of beige cream all over every moving part of the machine. My guess is they thought it would not sell without a video of it running. Thanks to that awful beige goop, I've had so much fun taking Mrs. Colleen 90% apart. The main shaft was luckily spared from the goop. Thanks to you and Andy Tube, I've learned so much about how to take apart my machine, how to clean the different types of parts, and learn more about Singer sewing machines than I ever thought I would. I have everything cleaned, and the motor rewire parts arrived today. Over my upcoming Christmas break, my husband, who wired my house, is going to rewire the motor for me while I put everything back together. For 2024, I'm going to be cleaning my grandmother's 1948 British 201K to mark the 1 year of her passing. My grandmother was always so proud that one of her granddaughters learned to sew and that I kept at it my whole life. Plus, knowing that the machine has not been able to be used for close to 20 years due to old wiring, and I can get it running again for my mom to use, is awesome. My mom learned to sew on a 201K. I'm also working on building a working Model 27 from two machines I found on Facebook Marketplace. One had a beautiful Sphinx decaled body, but rusting parts, while the other has good parts for being 120 years old, but the body is an awful hand paint job. I hope between the two I can make one good working machine so I can learn to sew on a treadle. Feel free to use any of my pictures in your video, and even if I don't make it into the video, just getting to tell you about my machines and saying thank you for helping me learn so much is awesome enough for me. Lanette Martin, I'm sorry, Macon, Georgia.
Oh, and there's more.
Oh, good grief. Oh, and just because I know you're a cat person too, here are my fur babies. Jay is my 5-year-old orange baby, and Turtle is my son's 5-month-old kitten.
Well, cool. I got a comment on that beige goop. That beige goop was probably stuck in there by a sew-and-vac shop somewhere along the way. I don't know anybody now who uses that stuff, but at one point it was very prevalent in the industry. And I think most people have moved away from that goop, but you're lucky you got it while it was still in goop mode, because once that stuff turns into crust mode, you need a chisel and a hammer to get that crap off.
Yep.
So, you are indeed fortunate. And by the way, Lanette is the one who sent me, she had sent me links to web pages. There was like 500 pictures of that. That's why you saw so many pictures while Liz was talking about Lanette's stuff.
Okay.
Okay, this next one is from Rex Franklin. I don't know where Rex is from. I couldn't find anything that indicated where. But anyway, Rex writes, "Hi Bob and Liz. I found this Singer So Handy Model 20 from the early 1950s in a secondhand store, and I just had to have it. I, for one, can understand that. Growing up with cystic fibrosis and not being able to attend grade school in the 1960s, my great-grandmother taught me how to knit and crochet. My grandmother and mother taught me how to sew on a Singer sewing machine.
That's awesome.
No, this is what's awesome.
Okay.
What's coming up here, this paragraph, is this makes Rex my hero. I have always had a sewing machine. When I was dating my wife, she asked me why I had a Singer sewing machine and if I knew how to sew. I went to the fabric store and made her a summer dress.
Woohoo!
You, Rex, are my hero. Being at retirement age, I have gotten into collecting vintage Singer machines and their attachments. I'm a Singer collector nut. My project is putting together having full attachment sets for each of my current 8 Singer sewing machines. Most of the items I picked up for free or a few dollars. The green red stripe oil can was given to me and has never been opened. The foot pedals and extra I picked up for $5, and the green box buttonholes, 15-91 manual, and a 301 box of attachments. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year's, Rex Franklin. Merry Christmas, Rex. An awesome story. You know,
I would love to have only 8 machines in this house.
Well, no. When you're dating a girl and she says, oh, do you know how to sew? And that's the ultimate way of, do I go to the fabric store,
here,
make her a dress? Bravo, sir. Bravo. Elizabeth, what do you have?
Okay. From Robbie Kieffer of Lawrence, Kansas. Bob, some additions to the year-in-review SMQ pile that clearly won't be Q. My first restoration, a Singer 66, number one. This was a Model 66, one of 50,050, allotted on December 6, 1921. It was an estate sale purchase of a person known locally as the Quilt Lady. There were at least 4 machines in similar condition, all in treadle tables. I've still got on the list to rework the table. My intent is that this machine will go back with its table. It started off as a simple Q-tips and rubbing alcohol cleaning and quickly got out of hand. I even took out the main shaft before I found your channel. Along with much polishing and cleaning, I stripped the original enamel and decals off, though it sort of looked okay, it really wasn't. I then applied what must have been about 30 coats of black shellac based on a recipe I found on pungoliving.com. The decals were from an Etsy seller in Australia. It took a while to get them, but they're quite close to original. I then put 10 to 15 coats of more of clear shellac before reassembly. She makes a lovely stitch.
Interruption real quick. That Etsy seller in Australia is where I got the decals for the Wheeler and Wilson.
Yeah.
That's coming up.
And you've talked about him being a good guy.
Yes, he's got good decals. Continue.
My second restoration, a white family rotary. This is a white family rotary, best as I can tell from around 1906. So old it had to be belt driven, as it doesn't have the motor mount bosses that become present on later versions. She came from someone on Facebook who was going to take this and the next 66 to the landfill. They have been stored in the barn. I was not able to find any videos, good or bad, or much information on this one, but used the experience gained on the first 66 to do it anyway. The purple liquid is simple green and the ultrasonic cleaner with a stream of schmoo coming off the parts.
Yes.
As per the usual, there was lots of schmoo. This one got the sandblast and repaint treatment. In this case, automotive spray paint, white primer, white base coats, 3 top coats of pearl gold, and the decals, same Etsy seller as the 66, and then 3 clear coat layers. I even re-chromed, nickel actually, the needle plate and stitch length regulator plate. This one also makes a decent stitch, but I assume would be more used for a decorative piece.
Oh, not according to Jill Mercer. She would sew with that.
Yes. My words of wisdom for anyone else who does a white restoration is something isn't coming out, you've missed a hidden set screw.
Words to live by.
Yeah. My third, sort of in parallel with the white FR, cherry, This is a Model 66, one of 50,000 allotted on February 28, 1922. This one came with the white. Yes, it was in a barn. In the mud, apparently. And yes, you're right. That is a nail in the top vertical shaft bearing hole, oil hole that was being used as a spool pin. Surprisingly, it rotated freely by hand. I'll let the before pictures speak for themselves. This one also got the down-to-bare metal treatment. Black primer, black glitter coat, glitter base coat. Oh, wow. Candy clear red. Okay. Decals from a person in Florida, then three clear overtop. This one's getting a motor, though I've been implored by my daughter to keep this one. The fourth, Blue 01, which is a 201-2. This is a Centennial Edition 1954 201-2 that I purchased from a Facebook seller. It had been their grandmother's and they didn't want it anymore. As you can see, much schmoo, dust, grime, etc. I reworked the motor and wiring thanks to your videos and did the full treatment. Everything out, cleaned, etc. This one also got the bare metal treatment, then black primer, silver glitter base coat, candy blue top coats, oh man, decals, the Florida person again, and three coats of clear. We love this machine. It's virtually silent and makes fabulous stitches. We're definitely keeping this one. I've made several things with it, including a stuffed unicorn for my daughter. I'll send a picture of that separately. They're sleeping currently. It's a real fun thing to take a rusty, muddy, barely turning sewing machine that's 100 years old or more, spend some time with it, and make something that somebody can use to make things with and give them a second life. I don't intend to make a business out of it. For me, it's a fun hobby. I truly appreciate your videos. The series with your Red 66 was a relatively constant companion for the first reassembly. The pictures of the stuffed unicorn that was made on the 201-2. Her name is Tealby, because when our daughter was younger, a teal unicorn made frequent appearances in bedtime stories, and the stuffed unicorn shares the name with the story unicorn. Thanks as always. Robbie Kieffer, Lawrence, Kansas.
That is super, super cool.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people are doing some interesting repaints. As you all know, Liz and I recently acquired a Barbie-fied 66 from our good friend Marie Hill. But I'm seeing a lot of people using a lot of pearl-type automotive paints now.
So pretty. So pretty.
I mean, I did one with tractor paint. Actually, I've done two with tractor paint. I did a Ford blue and, of course, the International Harvester red. But, yeah, I mean, what people are doing painting machines now, some people get a little offended by it. But, you know, these things, they made millions of them. Millions. Don't be pissed because somebody painted a machine. They made millions. It's great. Let people be creative. Have fun.
And the candy apple colors are just gorgeous that's pretty anyway. Cool.
Okay, moving right along. From Steve Asay in Florida, Steve writes, "Hi Bob, my name is Steve from Florida. I've been playing with these old Singers for only about 4 months. First one was the family 1966 Singer 66 Treadle. Then I found a 1936 Singer 201 that was very dusty and full of crud. Here are some pics from when I picked it up. Being very new to this, I started cleaning it for use for quilting. Then came the motor, and finally getting to use it for quilting. And I have to include the new to us 66 that my wife claimed for doing bags and light leather work when I get it done. And last week's find that I'm falling in love with, my first three-quarter machine, a 1949 Singer 128. You want to really fall in love, wait till you get a 99 in your hands.
Oh, man.
Thanks for all the detailed videos, lists, and manuals. You make it possible for us in the Schmoo Club to be able to bring some life back to these beloved machines. Fine, Steve. Well, Steve, thank you for watching, and thanks for keeping them alive and bringing them back to life. And when you get that 128 done, send pictures of that as well.
Yeah, really.
All right, I think you have one more?
One more. All right, this is from Sue Green of Roaring Spring, Pennsylvania. Hi, Bob. I don't usually do this, but here goes. I'll see if the images all send. The first two are of a 1929-99 that I started working on but haven't finished. I picked it up at a secondhand store on Route 13 near Chincoteague, Virginia. They say it ran, but I haven't tried it yet. I think this is one of your favorite methods of wiring. Not. I do have the knee lever. I also have another 99, two 201s, four 301s, two featherweights, a 206 K25, a 66 red eye, and a 127 in a treadle base. My Janome sits unused anymore.
Yeah, I can't understand why.
Yeah. The third picture is a quilt that I pieced on my 1956 301. I am now hand quilting it. The fourth picture is a wall hanging that I also pieced on my 301 and hand quilted this year. The following pictures aren't machine related, but with your music background, I thought you'd be interested. Hopefully the next picture's uploaded. We got to see our granddaughter in the West Virginia Middle School All-State Orchestra in March. She made first violin. She was then in seventh grade, her second year to go. Tryouts haven't happened yet for this spring. She also went to West Virginia Middle School All-State Chorus this year. Besides that, she does track, cross-country, and swimming. Our grandson is in hockey, soccer, Boy Scouts, and is taking cello lessons in fifth grade. He hasn't had any orchestra concerts yet. As you can see, they keep us busy, although they are almost 3 hours away, so we don't get to attend as much as we'd like. I wish you a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. Sue Green. By the way, I really enjoy your videos and recommend them on Facebook to anyone looking for help. Awesome.
Well, thank you, Sue.
Awesome.
That's what we have from you guys. As far as year in review for us, I lost track of how many projects we've done this year, how many motors that have been rewired. This was a year of potted motor rewires. But as far as like major accomplishment for the year that I personally take the greatest satisfaction in, it doesn't have to do with any particular sewing machine. What gave me the most satisfaction and brought the most happiness to me was actually a couple of things. Number one was being able to restore some machines and sell them and donate the proceeds to New Jersey Blind Citizens Association. Through the sale of machines, we raised well over $1,000 for NJBCA, which I thought was pretty cool. But the one thing that really, really...
Pet Adoption Network, too.
Oh, yeah, and Pet Adoption Network. That's true. Thank you. Yep. But the one thing that happened out of this room that really made the most difference to me was I got a chance to play a rather small part in bringing two people together, my good friends Jen Delio at Sewing Machine Rehab and Marie Hill at Promethean Sewing Machines. Got those two talking to each other, and oh my God, what has happened since then has been amazing. I don't know how many of you have been following either Jen or Marie or both. They recently did a project where they redid a the featherweight that belongs to Pat Sloan, who she's a quilter, crafter,
YouTuber,
huge following. But they did a huge project for her. Of course, we procured one of Marie's machines for our collection. I got a notification today that Marie is shipping me a machine that I'm going to finish off the mechanicals on it that she has painted, and the proceeds from the sale of that machine is going to go to Pet Adoption Network, which is awesome. I didn't ask her to do that. She's out of her own. She painted a 201-2 and did it in a cat theme. So I'm sure the people who are members of the Sewing with Cats Facebook group are going to be lining up to get their hands on a 201-2 that's cat-themed. But like I said, all the proceeds of that are going to be going to charity. And just knowing that these two ladies, these two lovely ladies, are have become really good friends, that has meant so much to me for this year. So, yeah, I think that pretty much says it all.
Yep, except that we need to wish everybody the best holiday ever.
That's true. And thank you all so much for watching. And I don't know if we're going to have a New Year's Eve. Maybe, yeah, we'll have to do something for New Year's Eve. We'll do something cool for New Year's Eve. It'll probably be tearing into something gooey and disgusting to get back to it.
Maybe it'll be something good food and drink.
Well, there could be that too. But anyway, thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you on the next video.